Hey everybody, welcome to this brave new virtual world we live in. Well, thanks for tuning in and for your interest in this presentation. And as a reward, I'm going to be telling you today about the largest gravity changes ever recorded, at least to our knowledge. Now, these were gravity changes that were associated with the onset and the early evolution of the 2018 eruptive activity at Kīlauea, the lower east drift zone eruption and the summit collapse. And before I launch into this, I'd like to make sure I acknowledge my co-authors. That's Daniele Carbone of INGV and Matt Patrick of the Hawaiian Volcano Observatory. The two of them really made this work possible. So let's talk about these huge gravity changes. As most of you probably know, Kīlauea had been erupting from two areas prior to the 2018 eruption. The first of these areas was Puʻu on the east drift zone. That eruption started in 1983 and went more or less continuously for 35 years. And then starting in 2008, a summit eruption was ongoing. This was manifested by lava lake activity just on the inner edge of Halemaʻumaʻu crater. Now in 2018, of course, we had the extrusion of over a cubic kilometer of lava from the lower east drift zone. Now this was fed by a dike that propagated down from Puʻu'o'o and eventually connected back up to the summit. Now in the early hours of this dike propagation, Puʻu'o'o collapsed. And you can see here, it was characterized by billowing plumes. And at the summit, the lava lake withdrew. That took a matter of a few days, and eventually the summit collapsed to form a new caldera. So this was all associated with this dike intrusion down to the lower east drift zone. Gravity monitoring was done by two continuous instruments. The first was located at the summit, in fact, just above the summit eruptive vent. This was station HOVL, right on the eastern rim of Halemaʻumaʻu crater. The second was located right on the north rim of Puʻu'o'o crater, station PUOC. And these two gravimeters had been running for several years at the time of the 2018 collapse. Now the installations looked something like this. We had power supplied by solar and batteries, telemetry as well. And the instrument was located in this little protective hut, this little doghouse, a tile roof that was meant to protect it from the elements and from any ballistics. You open up that doghouse, you can see that inside is a Lacoste and Romberg. In both cases, we used G meters that were fitted with the Aliad electronic feedback system. And so 2 Hertz gravity data and tilt data were streaming from the gravimeter into a data logger. Now this system remained in place at the summit as is, but at Puʻu'o'o, we eventually replaced the dog box with a Pelican case with a concrete floor and a slightly more advanced electronics that were more robust against failure. Well, let's start by talking about gravity change at the summit. What you're looking at here in this movie is a time-lapse animation of the thermal camera imagery of the summit lava lake. You can see it slowly receding through the first few days of May as the lower east drift zone dike tapped the summit magma system. And on the bottom is the gravity change that accompanied the withdrawal of the lava lake. Now, over this few day period, there was over a milligal of gravity change. This is the second largest gravity change ever recorded. Unfortunately, during this time, the summit went from looking something like this, where Halemaʻumaʻu was located in the center of the caldera, the gravimeter was located right on the eastern rim here, to looking like this. This was the ending view after several months of collapse. The gravimeter had been located right in here, and unfortunately, in mid-May of 2018, it was consumed by the widening of Halemaʻumaʻu as the collapse took place. Now, after withdrawal of the lava lake, but before collapse of the summit, aerial photos were used to construct a structure for motion, DEM, of the interior of the summit vent, and that's what you're seeing here on the left. There's also a plan view of the system with the location of the gravimeter noted by that dot that says HOVL and a cross section that shows what the vent looked like on a north to south profile. And we modeled this vent by breaking it into parallel pipe heads, these 5 by 5 meter cells, and we could simulate the level of lava over time by matching the level of lava as viewed in that thermal video. And so by doing this, we could actually simulate the gravity change that would occur as the lava lake withdrew. And since we know the level of the lava over time and the shape of the vent, the only thing that we had to solve for to match the gravity data was the density of the lava lake. The top plot shows the change in gravity over the first few days of May. And on the bottom is the lava level during the same time period, the lava level being derived from that series of thermal camera images. Now, by combining the lava level change with that structure from motion model of the interior of the summit vent, we were able to calculate a gravity effect simply by changing the density of the lava. When we do that, the best fitting gravity change is obtained with a density of about 1700 kilograms per cubic meter for the upper 200 meters of the lava lake. Now, this is a little bit denser than we'd seen before. During a past episode of lava lake withdrawal in 2011, we calculated a density of about 1000 kilograms per cubic meter. So it's possible that the density of the lava lake had increased over time. It may also be that we had a much, much more accurate model of the vent, and so we were able to get a more realistic density, although still clearly much less than the density of basalt, which reflects the gas charge nature of the lava in the vent. Well, let's move now to the Puʻu'ō vent. After Puʻu'ō collapsed and once the ash plumes cleared, there were helicopter overflights and lots of photos taken, and we were able to do the same thing at Puʻu'ō as we were at the summit. That is, use the photos to construct a structure from motion model of the interior of the eruptive vent. You can see that model here in perspective view on the left and in plan view in the lower left. That also features the location of the PUOC gravimeter. And then the cross section on the right shows what this looked like in side view from east to west. Now, the difference between Puʻu'ō and the summit was that we did not have any information on the lava level over time at Puʻu'ō. Unfortunately, the camera views were not able to see into the vent, so we only know about the time that the lava level started to drop at Puʻu'ō. We don't know anything about how that drop occurred, but that's something we were able to invert for as part of our analysis of gravity change at Puʻu'ō. And the gravity change at Puʻu'ō was really impressive. You might recall a few slides ago, I showed the summit gravity change. We had about a milligal of gravity decrease over several days, the second largest change ever recorded. Well, at Puʻu'ō, over a matter of just a couple of hours, we had 1.5 milligals of gravity decrease, easily the largest gravity change ever recorded. Now, as I mentioned, we didn't have any lava level information, but that was something that we could invert for along with the lava density. When we do that, we get a lava level change that looks something like this, where about there were 300 meters of lava level drop over the course of the 2 hour or so draining of the lava level at Puʻu'ō. So now we can also use this to calculate the lava density, and we get about 1900 kilograms per cubic meter. And the volume loss over this 2 hour period was 11 million cubic meters, or 8 million cubic meters dense rock equivalent. Now, this density is significant for two reasons. It's greater than that at the summit. And so first, that may reflect pre-eruptive degassing at the summit. We know that some of the magma that degassed at the summit then later went down to Puʻu'ō where it erupted. So it stands to reason that we would see a higher density of the lava lake at Puʻu'ō relative to the summit. And second, the lava level elevation at the summit is higher than that at Puʻu'ō. And that might also reflect a greater density of lava at Puʻu'ō. And in fact, this difference of about 200 kilograms per cubic meter is roughly what you would expect given the lava level elevation difference at the summit in Puʻu'ō. So the density that we're seeing at Puʻu'ō and the summit are very consistent with observations from degassing and surface elevation. Now, and there's another signal here that I think we need to spend a little bit of time focusing on, and that's this little transient right here, a 200 microgal decrease followed by a 400 microgal increase just a few minutes before Puʻu'ō collapsed. And this may indicate something that occurred prior to the onset of the Great Dike Intrusion that fed the big Lower East Rift Zone eruption in 2018. So here's a zoomed view of that gravity transient that occurred just a few minutes before collapse of Puʻu'ō. And on the bottom is tilt, measured at a tilt meter just on the north flank of Puʻu'ō. And you can see the tilt was starting to accelerate early in the hours of May 1st. But this gravity transient really showed up quite strongly before there was really strong ground tilt. And in fact, it showed up just after the onset of some interesting seismicity out at Puʻu'ō, an increase in seismic tremor. This may have been associated with the onset of a small fissure eruption on the west flank of Puʻu'ō. So here is Puʻu'ō cone. This photo was taken after the collapse. but at the time it was noted that there was a small fissure that ran down the west side of the cone, and this fissure had a very small amount of lava that had come out of the ground, mostly degassed lava. This gravity signal, the decrease followed by the increase, may indicate the onset of this small fissure, the opening and then filling of this fissure with magma. So it may be that we're seeing the opening sequences of the entire eruption, a small fissure on the west flank, very strongly manifested in the gravity data from Puʻu ʻŌʻō. Now, with only one gravity station, it's really impossible to model this, but we can come up with a conceptual model of what this might mean. Now, the opening gravity decrease could represent the opening of a dry crack, something that you might see in front of a propagating dike. So the dry crack opens, the overall density decreases because you're replacing rock with air, and gravity goes down. Then eventually, magma fills that crack, and we get an increase in gravity. And in this case, at Puʻu ʻŌʻō, the gravity increase was much greater than the decrease because the magma filling that crack would have a much, much higher density than the agglutinated spatter that makes up the cone. And so we might explain this gravity transient as the opening of this dry crack and then the filling with dense, mostly degassed magma that had a small eruption on the west flank of this fissure. So gravity data provide an interesting perspective into what could have been the very opening sequence of the entire 2018 eruption, a small fissure that opened on the flank of Puʻu ʻŌʻō. So we just find these results incredibly exciting. Not only can we use the continuous gravity data to identify things like the volume of magma that drained from Puʻu ʻŌʻō and the density of that magma, we may also be able to detect much more strongly than other measures, other monitoring data like tilt or seismicity, the occurrence of very important transients. So in conclusion, we've seen gravity changes of a milligal and 1.5 milligals at the summit in Puʻu ʻŌʻō respectively. These are the largest gravity changes that we're aware of ever having been recorded. Now, using these data and models of the eruptive events, we were able to calculate a density of the summit lava lake of about 1,700 kilograms per cubic meter, while the Puʻu ʻŌʻō lava lake density was slightly higher at 1,900 kilograms per cubic meter. This density difference is very interesting. It's consistent with pre-eruptive degassing that was occurring at the summit vent, and also the difference in the elevations of the two lava lakes. And finally, there's this major gravity transient, a 200 microgal decrease followed by a 400 microgal increase, all occurring over the course of just a few minutes. And this preceded the onset of the 2018 dike intrusion. It preceded the collapse of Puʻu ʻŌʻō. This may have been the opening event of the entire sequence, and it was indicated more strongly in gravity than any other data set. This really is a great argument for a continued investment in monitoring using continuous gravity, which hopefully in the years to come will become cheaper and easier as new technology is applied. Well, there you have it, the story of the largest gravity changes ever recorded. Hope you found that interesting, and if you have any questions, feel free to email me anytime, mpoland@usgs.gov. Thanks for tuning in and seeing it out to the bitter end, and hope to see you at a future conference sometime soon when this is all over and we're back to normal. Take care, everyone.